So you mentioned earlier about methane in the Arctic, and I've heard about people talking about methane bursts. It all sounds very dramatic. So what that's about and how quickly it might happen, or what the prognosis is for that?
Well, it could happen very suddenly, and I think it's the greatest single threat that we face, but that's not generally recognised by the IPCC. And the origin is this fact that the sea ice is retreating in summer. So what we used to have in the Arctic is a very interesting ocean, because the centre of it is very deep, like most oceans. It's 4,000 metres deep, but it's got the widest continental shelves of any ocean. And so this whole area around the edge of this, of the Arctic, which is the seas north of Russia, basically the East Siberian Sea, Laptev Sea, Kara Sea, these are very wide shelves, and the shelves are incredibly shallow, only 50 to 100 metres deep. So it's like a swimming pool with a very shallow end and a very deep end.
Right.
So that you've got 50 to 100 metres going out right up into the middle of the Arctic virtually. Then suddenly it goes deep and you have the very deep ocean. Now the trouble is that the summer retreat of sea ice has taken it back into the centre of the Arctic Ocean. So the deep part of the Arctic Ocean still has an ice cover in the summer, but the shelves don't. The ice has completely gone off the shelves. And so we have open water and shallow open water as well. So that means in the summer, when you're getting lots of solar radiation, you're getting that radiation is hitting a shallow layer of water and warming it up. So instead of the water temperature staying at zero, which is what would happen in the past when we still had ice, the water temperature has risen to several degrees. 3 years ago, it was 11 degrees up here. So if you look at 11 degrees, that's the temperature of the North Sea. In Scarborough, I think people go swimming. so that's with those temperatures, when in the past you always had zero or less, it has a dramatic effect on the seabed, because the seabed is like a pressure cooker. It's got a layer of permafrost left over from the last ice age, that's holding down several hundred meters of sediments, which are full of methane. And as soon as you release the pressure, that turns back into methane gas and comes out. We did an analysis in Nature, which was based on an estimate that only maybe 8% of the methane came out. That's still 50 gigatons a year. And that would have an impact, climatic impact, of increasing air temperatures worldwide by 0.6 of a degree.
So if I'm right, then the average, the CO2 output at the moment is about 40 billion to 40 gigatons, isn't it? 40 billion tons. And methane is, what, 23 times more powerful than CO2?
Yes. So,
and there could be 50 billion tons of that coming up.
So that would be a one-year burst that would have an impact at least 20 times the impact of CO2. So it will be a catastrophe, because the temperature would suddenly rise. Wouldn't be rising smoothly, but it would rise by, even with 8% of the methane being released, it gives you 0.6 of a degree warming straight away. So it baffles me that IPCC has not taken account of that in its assessments.
I know you've been on record as saying that you feel that the prognosis in the IPCC report is pretty woefully underplayed, you know, obviously the Paris Agreement was 2 degrees maximum and aspire to 1.5, and then this latest IPCC report has come out. They're saying it's even more important that we now shoot for 1.5 degrees maximum. But it seems to me that looks less and less feasible as every day goes by.
Well, I think it never was really feasible. Even the IPCC's own analysis said we've got to reduce emissions to zero by 2050. And we can't, and they're not even decreasing at all. They're still increasing exponentially. Yeah. The CO2 level in the atmosphere is still going up at an unrestrained rate. Now, when the signing of the Paris Agreement didn't produce a sudden decrease in CO2 levels or CO2 emissions, they just kept going up. The world didn't notice. If, for instance, an asteroid was spotted heading for the planet, then the whole world would mobilise to do something about it and kind of launch some giant mass of nuclear weapons to try and divert it. We wouldn't just sit there supine and let it hit us. But because climate change, which is going to be just as destructive, it's going to make human life impossible, but because it will take decades to happen, everybody from day to day can sort of think, oh, I don't need to do anything now, I'll do something sometime in the future. It's a natural human reaction. You really, to face up to this need for 1.5 or 2 degrees restriction on warming, you have to completely trash immediately all fossil fuel power stations.
Yeah.
You have to stop drilling for oil, stop digging coal, get rid of fossil fuel power stations, replace them with solar, wind and nuclear immediately at huge cost, and people will object to paying that cost. Stop people from driving big cars and make it necessary to have an electric car if you're going to have a car.
Yeah.
Change people's lives to such an extent that people wouldn't tolerate it. If there isn't an immediate threat, if there isn't that asteroid heading for us, they won't do anything. So it won't get done. And that's my fear. It's not a fear. I think it's a prediction. We won't see any reduction in carbon emissions. Far from reducing them to zero, it will shoot up to the point where we can't get it back down. And rightly, I think IPCC say, if we don't start to seriously reduce emissions within the next 2 years, we'll never get them down to a level that will save us.
I have recognised that the biggest issue I think we have is getting the message. You put it forward in a very, very easy to understand way, but I've listened to a lot of really technical presentations that you know, I'm not a stupid guy, I'm fairly intelligent, but I've had to really try hard to understand, and actually even reading the IPCC report, why use one word when 53 will do? That it's a very verbose report, and it's almost an exercise in demonstrating one's vocabulary expertise rather than trying to get a message across in words of one syllable, and that's part of the issue.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that's really bad. I've always felt that in science, that if you can understand a concept, you can get it across to an intelligent layman. You know, it ought to be possible to explain any concept in science. And if you can't explain it, then it's probably wrong. Made some mistake or something.
Yeah.
If you can't get something across, and of course scientists often don't like that, because they like to be able to maintain the mystique rather than saying something that everybody can understand, because when everybody understands it, everybody will say, oh, we always knew that. Everybody's saying about the Arctic, we always knew that the ice was going to disappear. In fact, everybody said it's not going to disappear, and
suddenly change their tune. Yeah.